Good morning and welcome to the 13th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2024. I've received no apologies for this meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 5, 7 and 8 in private. Are members agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. The second item on our agenda is an evidence session with the Minister for Public Health and Women's Health and supporting officials on the Victims and Prisoners Bill Legislative Consent Memorandum. I welcome to the committee Jenny Minto, Minister for Public Health and Women's Health, Sam Baker, Public Health Capabilities Division, James Howe, Public Health Capabilities Division, and Marie Penman, Scottish Government Legal Directorate, all from Scottish Government. The purpose of the Victims and Prisoners Bill is to require the Secretary of State to establish a body to administer a compensation scheme to victims of the infected blood scandal within 3 months of passing the Act. Due to time constraints in the passage of the bill at Westminster and subsequent lodging of the LCM at a late stage, the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee is also considering the LCM at its meeting today. Therefore, it will not be possible to include their conclusions in our consideration today. And I invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you for the opportunity to give evidence on this legislative consent memorandum, especially as I know you've had to arrange this session at short notice. I'm afraid this is because, as the Convener pointed out, the UK Government has only been able to table its amendments on infected blood compensation at a very late stage in Westminster. What happened to infected blood victims was a terrible tragedy, and the Scottish Government has apologised. The Scottish Government confirmed in its closing submissions to the Infected Blood Inquiry that it recognises the strong case for provision of compensation for all those infected with hepatitis and or HIV as a result of infected NHS blood or blood products, as well as their bereaved relatives. Given this context, I am supportive of the policy intent. These amendments are the first step in the implementation in full or in part of the inquiry's recommendations as set out in its second interim report. The inquiry recommended that compensation should be provided by one UK-wide scheme to ensure consistency of approach regardless of where in the UK an applicant lives or where they were affected. The UK government amendments do that by setting up a new arm's-length body called the Infected Blood Compensation Authority, which will deliver the Infected Blood Compensation Scheme. The amendments ensure that those in Scotland will have access to the scheme on the same basis as those elsewhere in the UK. Much of the detail, including eligibility and payment levels, will need to be set out in regulations, and I know that this has caused some concern. However, the Minister for the Cabinet Office, John Glenn, MP, wrote to me on the day the amendments were tabled, and I have replied to stress that the details of the compensation scheme should be set out as quickly as possible. Also, the inquiry's second interim report recommended that further interim compensation payments of £100,000 should be made to certain relatives of infected people, following the £100,000 interim payments made to infected people or their bereaved partners in October 2022. In response, the amendments also make provision for payments to the estates of infected people who have sadly died as a pragmatic method of ensuring that family members of the deceased get some compensation reasonably quickly. In my letter to the Minister for the Cabinet Office, I stressed that these payments should be made as quickly as possible. There is no doubt that the UK Government's last-minute lodging of amendments has left us in a difficult position, with practically no opportunity to negotiate changes. However, given that the amendments represent both a concrete step towards providing compensation to victims of this terrible tragedy and ensuring that relatives who have received nothing or very little so far receive interim compensation, I do recommend the Scottish Parliament consents. Through continued engagement with the UK Government, I will seek to ensure that the needs of the victims are put first and that the scheme works for all those victims in Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. And we'll now move to questions. And Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. I think everyone will want to get this legislation in place as swiftly as possible and establish the compensation scheme. In a submission to committee, while supporting the LCM, Haemophilia Scotland talk about serious concerns over some proposed changes which deviate from recommendations set out in the Compensation Framework Report and Second Interim Report. Can you talk to Scottish Government's thinking on these deviations, please?
Yes, I thank Ruth Maguire for her question and agree with your opening sentiments that it is important that we ensure that those people that have been infected and affected are supported as quickly as possible. I too share some of the concerns of both Haemophilia Scotland and the Scottish Infected Blood Group as well. The amendments that we're discussing today are UK government amendments, so I can't explain the detail of them, sadly. We have worked as closely as we can with the UK government. We've had a number of meetings, four nation meetings, to discuss the concerns in each of the nations. And I have, I suppose, from the concerns that some of the organisations are raising, not everything will be put on the face of the bill, and a lot of the work will be done on regulations. And this is where I see myself and also my officials working closely with the UK government to represent the views of the stakeholders, but also the thoughts of the Scottish Government as well.
Thank you. That's very helpful.
Santosh Gohani.
Thank you, Convener. Declaration of interest as a practising NHS doctor. Thank you for your statement, Minister. Can I ask, do we know the number of people affected in Scotland?
So, thank you for your question, Sandish Gulhani. We have been paying out through the SIBS fund the payments of £100,000 pounds from October 2022, and my understanding is that there are 22...
That's the estates.
So we know that there's 22 estates. Maybe, Sam, do you know the exact numbers?
So we don't know exactly how many people are infected or affected. SIBS has about 580 members at the moment. But there will be others who are affected, so people who've sadly died, who may have relatives that will wish to claim from the compensation scheme or claim the interim compensation. So we don't know exactly how many of those there are, and we're working with the UK government and the lawyers who hold the old files from the previous support schemes to try and establish how many there might be. But until people come forward and apply, you don't know exactly how many there are. Does that help?
When it comes to the payment of compensation, is this coming from the Scottish Government or is it coming from the UK Government?
So the recommendations and the interim recommendations was for a UK-wide compensation scheme, which would be administered by the UK Government, and therefore payments for this element would come from the UK Government.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Minister, you'll be aware that stakeholders have concerns about the appointment of Sir Jonathan Montgomery and the lack of transparency over the expert group membership, which I believe has not been published or publicised. And I'm keen to hear what Scottish Government's view is of the anonymity of that membership.
OK, thank you for the question. Yeah, and I understand the concerns of the shareholders with regards to this. I don't know the makeup of the external expert group either. What I did in one of the Four Nation meetings was ask for consideration for a Scottish, at least one Scottish member of the group. I don't know if that has happened. I have some sympathy for the anonymity of the group being maintained, but John Glenn, the Minister for Cabinet, is coming to Scotland next week and will be meeting with the stakeholders, and I hope that will give them an opportunity to discuss that with him.
And in terms of correspondence or contact with UK government regarding not having anonymity of those board members and also of a Scottish representative, what's Scottish government's plan going forward?
So I'm pleased that over the last year that we've had, I think, 4 intergovernment meetings around this, and also in the last few months, my officials have been meeting weekly, sometimes twice weekly. So any points that we have that we wish to raise with the UK government, we have a number of avenues in order to do that. I also intend to join the stakeholders with meeting Mr Glenn next week as well.
Okay, thank you. And Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Minister, you talk about a number of avenues. So moving forwards, how will the Scottish Government be working with the UK Government on this?
Thank Tess White for the question. And I think it's actually really important that we have the right processes set up. And I've been very clear from the meetings that I've had with the stakeholders in the last year that we will represent their views. And I have done that either in person on a Teams meeting or via written letters, along with my colleagues in Wales and Northern Ireland. As I laid out in my response to the convener, my officials are meeting with officials from the UK government, from the Cabinet Office, also with the Welsh Government and Northern Irish Executive as well, to ensure that all 4 nations are represented in this.
Thank you.
Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. Thank the Minister for her statement. Would the Minister consider that a parliamentary correspondence with the UK Government might be helpful? I know the Lords are sitting today to consider amendments on these recommendations and may table further amendments. But perhaps if this committee were to express a view, would that be helpful to, you know, reach some support for the stakeholders who have expressed concerns, notwithstanding their overall support for moving forward, but perhaps giving voice, particularly around issues such as a judge-led approach, perhaps that may be helpful.
Yeah, I thank Paul Sweeney for that question and I suppose offer as well. As you know, we have a debate on this late this afternoon, and my intention from listening to the contributions from that was to write a letter to the UK government outlining what had happened in the chamber. I see no reason why the views of this committee should not also be shared, and whether you want to do that separately or as part of that. I think it's probably better if you do it separately, then I have no concerns about that, because going back to Ruth Maguire's first question, the importance is that we think about those infected and affected, put these people at the centre of our decision making, which I'm sure you will do.
Thank you. There's no further questions from the committee, so I'd thank the Minister and her officials for their attendance today, and we'll briefly suspend to change panels. On our agenda is consideration of one affirmative instrument, the registration of social workers and social service workers in Care Services Scotland Amendment Regulations 2024. The purpose of the instrument is to amend the registration of social workers and social service workers in Care Services Scotland Regulations 2013 to reduce the period of time for workers to apply for registration with Scottish Social Services Council, with the requirement now being that they do so within 3 months of starting a new role. The policy note states that the objective is to encourage social workers and social service workers to apply for registration sooner after starting work, which will allow the assessment of an applicant's fitness to practice at an earlier stage, providing greater public protection. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered this instrument at its meeting on the 19th of March 2024 and made no recommendations in relation to the instrument. We will have an evidence session with the Minister for Children and Young People and Keeping the Promise and supporting officials on the instrument. And once we've had all our questions answered, we will proceed to a formal debate on the motion. And I welcome to the committee Natalie Dawn, Minister for Children, Young People and Keeping the Promise, Rona Carson, lawyer from Scottish Government Legal Directorate, and Jamie McIntyre, Team Lead, Scottish Social Services Council Sponsorship Team, all from Scottish Government, and invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener and Committee Members, for inviting me here today to speak to the draft registration of social workers and social service workers in Care Services Scotland Amendment Regulations 2024. Now, these regulations are relatively straightforward in that they amend the timescale that an individual must apply for registration to the Scottish Social Services Council. This SSI plays an essential part in the Scottish Social Services Council's future-proofing programme, suite of work which seeks to modernise and simplify registration to ensure that the service that is provided is fit for future need and that public protection is always at the forefront. Now, existing legislation currently requires all individuals registered with the Scottish Social Services Council to apply for registration as soon as reasonably practicable after starting work, with a six-month timescale for registration to be complete. Now, whilst the six-month timescale to fully gain registration will still be in place, the draft SSI brought to committee today seeks to amend the deadline for applying for registration to 3 months, and this change will set a much clearer expectation for workers. Now, when the future-proofing programme was developed, it was identified that individuals who are required to register as part of taking on a role in care often left it very close to the deadline to apply for registration, and that could impact their continued employment if it was not completed in time. Now, this amendment will bring greater clarity on what is expected and will encourage people to apply for their registration sooner. This change will reduce the overall timescale and the gap between an individual starting employment and their fitness to practice being assessed. It will lead to greater public protection by deeming if an individual meets the standards of character, conduct and competence necessary for them to do their job safely and effectively in line with the Scottish Social Services Council's codes of practice. Now, the Scottish Social Services Council carried out a consultation on the Future Proofing Programme. This ran between December 21 and March 22. The consultation received over 6,500 responses, 91% of which were registrants. In relation to the proposals brought to the committee today, 78% of approximately 3,000 responses agreed that 3 months after starting their role is an appropriate timescale to require workers to apply for registration. 75% agreed that this would make it easier for employers to comply with the requirements. The Scottish Government then carried out a consultation late in 2023, which concluded in January, focusing on three imminent aspects of the future-proofing programme, of which this change was one. 77% of respondents to this consultation agreed with the proposed amendment to registration timescales, including 10 key stakeholder groups. Although the majority of residents were supportive, some concerns were raised, with the key issues being around the potential burden on the Scottish Social Services Council staff during that transition phase, 3 months being too short a timescale for new workers, and how this change would interact with the standard 6-month probationary period workers are subject to. In light of these concerns, further investigation was carried out. Accordingly, staff at the Scottish Social Services Council will receive appropriate training on implementing the changes ahead of them going live. New and probationary workers will receive support from their employer to gain registration, with the obligation continuing to fall on the employer to ensure that that time frame is met. Now, guidance and information are currently being sent directly to employers to make them aware of these changes. The Scottish Social Services Council are hosting online events for employers and workers up to and after the launch of the legislation and the new changes on the 3rd of June 2024. The Scottish Social Services Council have also published full details on their website of all the changes being made as part of that future-proofing programme, including an employer's toolkit. This includes information on the three-month deadline, stating that anyone starting a role from the 3rd of June 2024 will be subject to that three-month registration period. Ensuring the law is clear on when an individual should be registered by creates a driver for employers and for workers to meet that mandatory timescale. By clarifying the timescale for applying for registration, this lessens any potential risks to those receiving services, including some of our most vulnerable citizens. The legislation before the committee today is an essential part of a process designed to ensure that public safety is at the heart of social services in Scotland. I hope that members will support this draft instrument.
Thank you very much. Minister, can I ask a question with regards to the three-month deadline? So you said in your opening statement there that there was concern that registrants were leaving it until almost the six-month deadline previously, and that's one of the reasons why this has changed, or this proposal is there for change. So what measures have been put in place to ensure that people going into new employment from the 3rd of June know that there is a three-month deadline, but also to ensure that they don't wait until 2.5 months into employment?
So we would hope that employers will be supported. Well, we would be sure that employers are helping to support their employees with that. As I said in my opening statement, convener, SSSC published a page on their website in March which details all the changes to registration as part of that future-proofing programme. It includes information on that three-month registration deadline, which states that anyone starting from the 3rd of June will be subject to that period. SSSC are also sending information directly to employers so that they're aware of the changes, and they're holding a series of online events for both employers and workers to ensure that any questions are answered or nothing's left unturned.
And will there be any leeway for registrants who start on the 3rd of June if they tip over into that over 3 month deadline? What's the contingency there?
So there would be support for that. I'd maybe ask officials just to come in with some of the details around that.
Yeah, SSSC have guarantee that they'll be putting in support in place, so that would start with dialogue. So I don't think there's any, it wouldn't be an immediately punitive approach that would be taken. It is a new change, and that's accepted, and so, there'll be continued work. But I think the feeling is it has been very well communicated, and there's a good awareness out there and a lot of positivity. So it's not expected that, that would be a very small proportion who could fall into that.
Emma Harper.
Convener, good morning to you. Just as you're talking about communicating to employers and employees, I'd be interested in whether you're monitoring or tracking or follow-up for people who only respond or people who might not be engaging. Is that something that will be proactively followed up?
Yes.
Okay. Easy answer.
Yes.
And I've had no indication that anyone else has a question, so I can thank the Minister. We now move to agenda item 4, which is the formal debate on the instrument, on which we've just taken evidence. Can I remind the committee that officials may not speak in the debate? Minister, can I ask you to move and speak to motion S6M12990, lodged by Natalie Don?
I'll formally move. I've nothing further to add. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. The question is that motion S6M12990 be approved. Are we all agreed? Thank you. And that concludes consideration of the instrument and also concludes the public part of our meeting today. Thanks.